Welcome to another edition of Resilient Living Podcast, a show dedicated to improving quality of life for both people and planet through liberation and independence, moving you from surviving to thriving and living life on your own terms. I'm your host, Adrian Babshoff. This is episode 02. And today I want to talk about recession survival for the rest of us. What does that mean? Well, before I get into what that means, the background noise is actually my vehicle. This is my work commute, my mobile studio where I podcast, my F-360 diesel pickup truck. So excuse the background noise. Today's talk is actually influenced of me at a conversation I had with my CPA about what's going on. And we both declared, we looked and we said, I don't see how there cannot be a recession. This is May of 2021, by the way. And it's really crazy. A lot of the stuff I try to understand, I tried to research about money and recessions and inflation and stuff like that. And I figured I would just kind of give you guys the best of my knowledge, what I can, within 15 minutes of what the rest of us, recession survival for the rest of us. See, we're in a K-shaped recovery, meaning that we have a straight line. If you imagine the letter K, COVID hit, everything kind of went down. Stimulus kind of brought us up a little bit. And right at the center of that line, we have an inverted line. That's the bottom of the K. And that's all of us middle class, poor people, and upper middle class, if that's even a thing. And we're getting hurt. We're starting to get hurt really, really bad. Well, we got other people, investors and people with money and savvy who do understand financial language and things like that. And they're capitalizing and they're actually doing better. So that's why I believe we haven't really called this a formal recession yet, because it's a K-shape. And that's what a lot of the economists are saying. And I know that's kind of difficult to comprehend, but I want to put it in the simplest forms that I can, because as I said, I'm a monkey too. I don't know if I can understand all of this stuff. But talking to my CPA, and we tried to figure out, well, what is the best thing to do? What's the wisest decision? And the very first thing I have on my notes here that we spoke about was to back off everything. People who are making money and they're capitalizing on this whole thing, they have money, they have the know-how. That does nothing for the rest of us. So this is not the time for us people who are upper middle class to middle class to poor. I'm talking people who even make like $100,000 a year. You may think that that's good money, but with the rise of inflation, meaning that if you make $100,000 a year, it's like you're only making $90,000, maybe even down to $80,000 on some circumstances. When you look at the cost of materials, food and gas and things like that, everything's starting to surge. When inflation goes up, it's very rare that it actually goes down. They work very hard to get it up. And they have to do that because they're printing money. And when they print money and they put that in circulation, there's more of the money. It's not backed by gold, if that makes sense. So what happens is the dollar doesn't have as much value as it used to. So things are going to cost more, if that makes sense. So a lot of people are fooled into thinking like, oh, I made $15 an hour, but now I'm making like $19 an hour. I got a raise, you know, I got like a 10% raise. Well, here in May 2021, I'm a contractor, and that's what me and my CPA were kind of talking about. I'm very knowledgeable more about materials and stuff like that since I deal with them. And the inflation's going to go up another 10%. That's since the first of the year. So what I'm trying to say here is that if you're making $15 an hour and you get a 10% raise, it actually does nothing for you other than it helps you out a little bit, but you're still in the exact same spot that you were in 2020. If you can wrap your head around that. Your food's going to cost more, and in some instances, some things are going to cost even more than what they were, so you're actually further behind. And it's very hard to stay on these details. So what do we do? We do not invest. I think I am warning, I'm putting it out there. I don't know if we are going to hit a recession. I just don't see how we can't. But even if we did not, if you stop buying cheap things, stop wasting your money on being a consumer, and buying things that are not essential in your life, and start socking money away. A lot of these smart people I listen to say that savers are losers. Cash is trash. And it's because of that inflation that I just explained to you guys about. A lot of people don't know this. They don't teach it in public school. A lot of our parents didn't know this. A lot of our grandparents didn't know this. We need to save our money. Yes, I understand that it's going to dwindle, but I look at it this way as no matter what you're going to do, you need emergency funds. And that's what we're going to teach you guys and share with you guys on the show of how I'm minimally affected by all of this. And I will continue to be, I think, for the rest of the year. But let's just say in a bank account that I've got $30,000 and that's a part of my emergency funds. That was back then. I need to start adding to 10% to that. So if you're like me and you have planned for these things and you got that money sitting there that's devaluating, you need to keep it there. That's not enough to invest. The way I look at to suck back, pull back from all this is to really think and really reinvent yourself. You got to start thinking of these numbers. You got to start thinking what's possible. But in order, if you were thinking of investing in a home or real estate, you know, and business and things like that, you got to make sure that you got your rear end covered. And that emergency funds needs to be there. So I always pretend like I don't even have it. That $30,000, that's not even there. I think we're going to add about $5,000 to that due to inflation in case I broke a leg or something like that, you know, and I couldn't work. I want to be able to have a year's expenses in advance. And some of you may be asking, how the heck would you live on that? Well, my overhead's super low. I live in a tiny home. As I said, I don't have time to explain my situation here today, but we will in another episode. But I can literally live off $2,000 a month and get by. I could probably even scrape even lower. But that's, we're talking nitty gritty. So sucking back, reinventing yourself, and learn the motions of things. Watch how things are interacting, how this economy is rolling out. And I think that the people who will survive things like this. Well, let's finish up too, that maybe there was never even a recession. That won't happen in 2021 or 2022. We do things here on the Resilient Living Podcast because it's good no matter what happens. So let's just say that the economy totally miraculously recovers. Now you've got all that money that you saved and you're able to use that to start a new business or to invest in whatever it is that you want or to keep your emergency funds up. Or just go right back to normal. It's your choice. But now you also have the practice and the ability of saving and knowing what that feels like, what that tastes like. So we need to learn to flow with things. And if there's one thing consistent in life is that nothing is consistent. And I think the faster we learn that, I mean, there's so many things that could happen, guys. There's been worse times that have happened, like the Great Depression, where people were starving. There was bread lines, soup lines, and things like that. Look into it. Do yourself a favor and educate yourself and really use your imagination of what that would feel like to not be able to feed your children, not even have a home, be sleeping out of your vehicle. And I mean, we've already got that. We've got tent cities popping up. We've got people sleeping in motorhomes on the sides of the roads. A lot of bad things are happening, and it's getting pretty scary out there. But you need to learn to flow with the changes. As I said, there could be an asteroid that would hit the Earth, you know, worst case scenario. There could be a volcanic eruption. I don't want to freak people out, but, you know, there could be an ice age, or like they're insinuating that it could be global warming. Well, if you lost your home, regardless, and we had no money to deal with anything, you know, it was just the shirt on your back and what you can farm and raise your own food, we'd still have to change. There would be times where we'd have drought and we'd have to move to where there's more water. So regardless of whether it's money or you're just living off the land, there's always going to be change and you need to learn to pivot with it. That's what I like about this whole thing of sucking back and just kind of getting a bird's eye view of things and just slowing everything down. Because guys, we don't really have to live this way. I've coined it the alternative lifestyle design because we need to figure out what the alternatives are. And when we look at the systems that are in design right now, the systems we have around us, they're failing us everywhere. And we keep putting band-aids with money, with the stimulus, and this doesn't really help anybody out majorly. It's a temporary band-aid. And my only guess is that they're trying to trickle everything in instead of just opening the floodgates and going, guys, we're in for a mess. You know, let's try to ease it in there. Quantitative easing. Look up what quantitative easing means in financial vocabulary. By stepping back, I think, and really slowing things down, we can kind of get that knowledge and that view. And I'd like to say, when you start simplicity in life, when you start living an alternative lifestyle design like me, you start to notice and you start to get more preoccupied with, well, what can I do? You know, there's a lot of stuff that we don't have control over, but when you start controlling every place of your life, every avenue that you can, you start to get more confidence. And in fact, it starts to take you the other direction where you're looking going, you know what, if I was able to do that, I bet you I could do other things. And then you start to practice and then you fail. And that's great because you just learned how that's not going to work. Now you can try it again and you've got the experience of where you can actually do things right and do things different. And you learn to pivot and you used to you're able to use your mind like a muscle. And I think it was Stephen Hawking who said that your mind is a muscle. And if you don't work out just like you do at a gym, it atrophies, it becomes weak. But those of us who exercise our brain, and don't get scared to just stop caring what other people think of you. And don't be so scared of failure. I think a lot of it comes from public education where you have to pass the grade no matter what, even though you're not getting it. We're forcing and forcing, and you're scared to death and to just, what if I get held back a grade, you know? And there's all these things in our modern life and society where I think a lot of people are viewing failure in a whole different way, whereas big businesses and companies fail all the time, governments fail all the time, and that's where we learn the most is from our failures more than our successes. And that's what empowers us. So failure is actually your friend, believe it or not. And the biology of belief, the thoughts that you have inside, you manifest inside your head, can actually affect your body. And it can make you very sad, it can make you depressed, and it can make you weak because you don't believe in yourself. And I'm going to tell you guys this over and over again on the lifetime of this show is what I tell my kids. I believe in you. I believe that you can do whatever you want to do. But that doesn't mean anything. You got to believe that you can do anything. You got to believe in yourself. So guys, exercise, use these exercises, these tools. Start believing in yourself. Start going out there, not being afraid of failure, because you're going to learn so much. And go and stop all this madness, as we talked about the last episode of all the paranoia and everything like that. Once you start understanding the numbers and you start understanding the way things are going, you start gaining more control of your life. So that's what I've got today, guys. If you guys like this sort of thing, give me a review. If I've given you any value, please like, subscribe, help me. Let me know that you guys are out there. I just want to explain that doing these shows is like talking to a wall. I have my phone right now hooked up to my visor on my truck. And when I'm talking, especially in the podcast realm, I have no idea if anybody's listening, how many listens and things like that. So I need to know if you guys are out there and this stuff works for you. And I'm going to get that email soon so you guys can contact me direct. We'll get a website. But all I want to know is see some traction in the comments and in the reviews and things like that so I can keep the show going for you guys. So guys, with that, that's the show. I want to bring this new one in, this new ending to the show, which is going to go something like this. Go out there and have yourself a near life experience. Don't lose your muchness. Carry on the fire and human up. Thanks for watching. I'll see you.